Grace, mercy, and peace be to you from God our Father and from our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. We live really in America in a post-Christian sort of world, full of confusing messages. A life of faith is a life of both saint and sinner. Feeling sometimes like that hamster in the wheel, circles, 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 over and over again. No matter how many times you review something to make sure it's right, still you forget to bold the last line in the psalm. And even with the help of your editors, who probably told you to bold it, you still forget to bold it. And this is one example among many. We all know how it is. We strive to do well in our lives, and there's always those little things that are just kind of always gnawing and nicking at us. Struggling with what we want and what God wants for us. Those things not always seeming to be in line. In faith, trying to get His way instead of ours. Daily drowning that old Adam. Remembering who we are in Christ because He washed us clean in the waters of holy baptism. Since we sometimes feel like we're walking in circles, let's make some markers on that circle and kind of, let's use the analogy of a baseball diamond. Home plate will be the law for us. First place will be the gospel. Second base will be faith. And third base will be good works in this wheel of Christian faith that we run through. The unbeliever and the believer alike step up to home plate and are hit square between the eyes with the law. This knowledge of sin drives us to first base. We are confronted with the reality of what forgiveness of sin is. Now this knowledge drives the unbeliever off the field, not interested in going around anymore. They do not think they are sinners, so they don't think they need forgiveness. For those of us who have faith and see forgiveness for what it is, the great gift that it is, we turn the corner to second base. As we turn the corner, the Holy Spirit places and strengthens faith within us, giving that growing faith that creates in us a desire. A desire to live a life in accord with God's word. In accord with His will above our own. We are now headed to third base. And it's there that we see lots of different messages. Lots of third base coaches, if you will. Some are saying, stop here and speak in tongues to prove that you are a Christian. Others are saying, stop here and try to be really holy before you move on. Others say, stop and, like the Pharisees, make lots of new rules to follow. Methods of being good to please God. Don't drink, don't smoke, don't dance, don't go to movies. But the Apostle Paul is waving you by. Go home. And what happens when you get there? Nailed between the eyes again with the law. And as we see from Paul's words to the Romans, I know that nothing good lives in me. That is my sinful nature. For I have the desire to do what is good, but I cannot carry it out. For what I do is not the good that I want to do, no. The evil that I do not want to do, this is what I keep on doing. Filled with sorrow and contrition, we head for first base again, saying, I, a poor, miserable sinner. And God's servant says, in the stead, and by the command, I forgive you. And we head for second base again. And He says, take, eat my body. Take, drink my blood. Forgiveness of sins for you. So invigorated and so excited, we head to third base and start to feel pretty good about ourselves. We're excited to share the faith that we have and get down to God's business. This time, the base is loaded with more coaches. An old football coach says, "Stop here and keep your promises." Someone else says, "Stop here," and hand you a "What Would Jesus Do" bracelet. A bearded psychologist says, "Stop here and join a self-help group in order to improve your life." An evangelist of a very large church in some city in Texas says, with a big smile on his face, "Stop here, read my book, and become a better you." Many of these coaches have lots of good advice. But St. Paul is now joined by Luther and Walther. "Don't stop here. You can make it. Go home. Go home." And again, we are clobbered by the law. And so the circle goes. And our understanding of our faith deepens. Our understanding of our sinful nature deepens. Our appreciation for the gospel is magnified. And our faith drives us to do good works, pleasing to God and, as best we can, with His help, we have more selfless motives than we do selfish motives. That brings us to today's circle, today's run around the bases in our first reading. We start at home plate. You remember what takes place there. In today's reading, in Acts, verse 29, we must obey God rather than man. But the world around us says, "Pastor, stop preaching about all that sin stuff. If you hear, as you go out in your daily life, you hear from your coworkers or your classmates, don't talk to me about sin. Don't rain on my parade with all that old dusty Bible stuff. Nobody really knows what that old book says anyway." We are obeying a God of our own creation. Jesus, by the way, says, "Judge not," after discounting the book, they usually quote it. "Judge not, so stop judging me. I will create a God, little g, in my own image, who will scratch my itching ears. Thank you very much." And then today's text persists with the painful truth of verse 30. "Whom you have killed by hanging him on a tree." Your sins, my sins, all of those sins are the sins that put Christ on the cross, not just the Pharisees who cried for his crucifixion. Just like the Pharisees, when they heard these words, they were furious. The world is furious when we say what God's word says, when we stand for God's word over and above man's word. Our world is furious when we say, "This is what God says. Living together, cohabitating, and not being married," I now must define that as one man and one woman, "is sinful. Even if you lose money by getting married. Even if getting married is not your preference." There's no such thing as a little lie. The things we say are either all truth or all falsehood. And if you allow someone to believe something that you know to be untrue and benefit from their ignorance, not only have you lied to them, but you've now stolen from them as well. Murdering inconvenient people, unborn, elderly, sinful, common practice in the world we live in. The list of things that we say and do which are not politically correct in our society is long. God says, "Pastor should be a husband of one wife." This speaks to gender. God says, "Those who eat and drink but do not believe drink and heap harm upon themselves. And we are called mean for trying to practice a form of communion that respects these truths. God says, remember the Sabbath day by keeping it holy. Not go fishing and pray with a pole in your hand. You can commune with God in the wilderness. I actually enjoy doing just that on a regular basis. But you cannot receive God's gifts as he has instituted them unless you gather together as his bride, the church, to receive those sweet gifts. My relationship with God is my business. And I will worship God in my own way, on my own terms. Well, that is a very beautiful American independent statement. But this is God's church, not yours, not mine. Not McDonald's. There's no drive-up window here. You cannot have it your own way. In God's church, we do things God's way. But God does not tell us it's my way or the highway. That's not how he works. He's loving, he's kind, he's patient. And while we try all kinds of new programs, he continues to be loving and kind and patient. I'm not saying that some of those guys standing on third place don't have a lot of good ideas, a lot of good things to say. They have lots of good information that's beneficial. But Christ did not die on a cross for you to have a better life now. He died on a cross for you to have eternal life. So as long as those third base programs don't stop you from going back to home plate on a regular basis, then maybe you can get something out of it. Today's text has some advice from a guy by the name of Gamaliel. He says, men of Israel, consider carefully what you intend to do with these men. Remember that guy named Thaddeus? Well, he had 400 followers. He was a flash in the pan. And now his followers have dispersed. Do-it-yourself and self-help programs in and of themselves are not evil things, but they cannot replace the gifts of God for God's people. Flash in the pan. Here today, gone tomorrow. That's the problem with most programs. They come to an end. Word and sacrament ministry never comes to an end until they are fulfilled in Christ in his second coming. So what lasts? What has staying power? And what won't run a course and come to an end? That which lasts, I'm afraid, is not popular. You can definitely build a large group of people saying what itching ears want to hear. Become a better you. Or doing what itching ears want to see. The first 500 who show up will get a free fill in the blank. It wasn't that long ago, a very large church that doesn't exist in our community anymore did that on Easter Sunday with bicycles, I believe. These marketing strategies work. But nowhere in Scripture is there an example of bait and switch practices. And God certainly is not pleased with deceptive growth models. A lie. Even a lie told with a good motive is still a lie. What lasts is often boring and dull, like running in a circle or running in that little cage, because it follows a biblical model. No, it's not sexy, but it carries the saints of God through to the church triumphant. And it carries us through times of suffering and plague in this existence. Can you imagine that pastor of a large mega church saying, rejoice in your suffering. Rejoice that you have been counted worthy, disgrace for the name. I try to imagine it, but no matter how much he smiles, I just don't think he could say that. That unnamed individual. Itching ears do not want to hear about suffering. And our suffering pales in comparison to the Christians in North Africa and the Middle East these days. But that is what St. Luke tells us in the book of Acts in verse 41. The apostles left the Sanhedrin rejoicing because they had been counted worthy to suffering for the name. So the next time you feel as if you're being flogged by a world that despises the name of the Lord and Savior that you confess to believe in, rejoice. The next time you find yourself suffering because the world despises the name of your Lord and Savior, rejoice. The next time you find yourself embarrassed or even disgraced by a world that despises the name of your Lord and Savior, rejoice. Rejoice in having been counted worthy to suffer for the name. And rest in the assurance of your salvation in that very name. In Jesus' name, amen.